Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is November 6, 2016. Today is All Saints Sunday, when we remember all the people that have passed this past year. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. If you would like to think about membership at St. John's, you can call the church or attend a service and talk to the pastor afterwards. St. John's has an outreach store that's open Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Friday, closed on Thursdays from 9:30 to 1 o'clock. We sell and donate used items donated by church members to people in need. We have a food pantry open every Wednesday, 9 to 10:45. We have a rainbow table luncheon every Friday, from noon to 1, and everyone's welcome.
November 6, 2016. This is All Saints Sunday. We're singing the song "Ye Watchers and Ye Holy Ones." It was written by Athelaston Riley, 1858-1945. It's an old German song from the 1600s. The melody is from the 1600s. The words are a little more contemporary. Written by Riley, 1858-1945. This is All Saints Sunday. We commemorate those who are knit together, people in one communion, in the mystical body of our Son Jesus Christ. All Saints Sunday. Those who have died, those who are living, and those who will be born. All body of the Son of Jesus Christ, mystical body.
We Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated as we listen to the reading of God.
Kim Jackson will be doing the readings.
Our first lesson this morning is from Daniel, chapter 7. In the first year of King Belshazzar of Babylon, Daniel had a dream and visions of his head as he lay in bed. Then he wrote down the dream. I, Daniel, saw in my vision by night the four winds of heaven stirring up the great sea, and four great beasts came up out of the sea, different from one another. As for me, Daniel, my spirit was troubled within me, and the visions of my head terrified me. I approached one of the attendants to ask him the truth concerning all this. So he said that he would disclose to me the interpretation of the matter. As for these four great beasts, four kings shall arise out of the earth, but the holy ones of the Most High shall receive the kingdom and possess the kingdom forever, forever and ever. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Becky Dimitrov will be doing the song.
Fullness of him who fills all in all.
The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
singing the gospel acclamation. Our pastor, Pastor John Pollock, will be reading the gospel.
Yuletide is 11 days away, so we can still need people to sign up to help with Yuletide. And we also need vendors for booths in the gym. November 22nd, we will have our Thanksgiving service, Tuesday the 22nd at 6:30 p.m. So please invite your family members and friends to join us on Thanksgiving Eve to celebrate our National Day of Thanksgiving. Now I ask that you give your attention to your wife.
Thank you.
you now take out your sermon notes, and as you do so, as we look at the blessed and suffering, the 22nd, 23rd verses of the gospel, 6th chapter of the Gospel according to St. Luke, share with you quickly a story I shared with Sunday school opening. As some of you know, the first Friday of every month, I go to Oakwood to do a communion service for the residents there. And I've been doing this since before Pastor Kay was a resident of Oakwood, so like 13 years I've been doing this. This past Friday, I had something happen I've never had happen before. The service was over, and I was beginning to prepare, clean up, and the elements and so forth, and I noticed this little older lady in the front row busily scribbling on a piece of paper. I hand him out an 11 sheet with the order of confession and forgiveness on it so they can participate when doing the confession. And then she left, and after I cleaned everything up, I noticed there was this paper on the altar, and I picked it up and I looked at it and I read, it said, "Pastor, I'm a graduate of Wittenberg University. And when I was at Wittenberg, we were taught that these words were pronounced," and she had three words listed there that she claimed I had pronounced wrong. And I even said in the sermon, I was from born and raised in Kentucky, and I thought that gave her a clue, but according to her Wittenberg education, I had mispronounced repercussions, Holocaust, and I can't remember what the third one was. But 13 years, nobody ever done that. For some reason, she did on that. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. We gather together this morning to honor, to remember, and to celebrate the most despised, the most hated, and the most persecuted people in all of history, the followers of Jesus Christ. From the beginning of the church in 30 AD until today, no group has been, a people have consistently been more persecuted, more tortured, more hounded, more hunted down, more imprisoned, or executed than we who proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord. You look about the world today and notice the number of countries where Christianity is abandoned, where it is harassed, and where its members are persecuted. Yet in all of this, Jesus tells us that we are blessed, that in suffering we are blessed. And so from Jesus' words in our gospel lesson today, verses 22 and 23, where we read, "Blessed are you when people hate you, and when they exclude you, revile you, and defame you on account of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for surely your reward is great in heaven. For that is what their ancestors did to the prophets." From these words, we should learn the following lesson. First lesson is what to expect from the world. Blessed are you when people hate you. That word hate, it means to detest someone. It means to despise them. It means to persecute. As followers of Jesus Christ, the world detests us, the world despises us, the world persecutes us because we do not go along with the world. The world has certain maxims that they say everyone should live by. Might makes right. Only the strong survive. Grab all you can and don't worry about whom you trample in the process of gaining what you want. The one who dies with the most toys wins. Seek fame, fortune, prosperity. These are the motivations of society. Or on the other side, seek pleasure. Eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow you die. Well, then along comes Jesus Christ, and he tells us that isn't what life is all about. That might does not necessarily make right. That the strongest only survive when you turn your back on your neighbor. That the things of this world, the materialism, the just trinkets when you think about eternity. Because moth and rust destroy them and thieves break in and steal. So what is important in life is not what the world says is important. But what is important is that right relationship with God through faith in Jesus Christ. To love God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. To love your neighbor as yourself. And as a follower of Jesus Christ in the community of faith, to love one another as Jesus has loved us. That is the willingness to sacrifice for each other for the good of the church and the good of the community of faith. And so, of course, the world hates us because we do not go along with their ideas. Rome had the idea that because they had the might and they controlled the world, that whatever they did was blessed by the gods that they believed in. And that the nations they conquered obviously believed in weak gods and goddesses because they could not stand up to the brutal force of the Roman legions. But then here comes Jesus talking about loving your enemy and praying for those who persecute you and turning the cheek to someone who strikes you, to giving someone not only your coat but your shirt as well if they're in need, to give to those who beg for you. And the world just cannot understand. It makes no sense to the world. Martin Luther, speaking about being a Christian, said, quote, "Thus no name has ever appeared on earth so slanderous and disreputable as the name Christian," end of quote. Now Luther said that in the 16th century. We've had 5 centuries pass on since then, and his words are still as true today as they were when he said, "No name was more slanderous or disreputable than the name Christian," when we consider the entire world. So the first thing to expect from the world is they despise us, they detest us, they persecute us, they hate us. Second is they will exclude us. Blessed are you when people hate you and when they exclude you. The word exclude means to separate from others. It means to cast out of society as being wicked and abominable. Those who convert to the Christian faith from the world's religions, those who convert to the Christian faith in lands that are ruled by tyrants and dictators, know this all too well. During the heady days of the Iron Curtain, to become a Christian behind the Iron Curtain was to be excluded, to be separated from the party, to be stripped of all your positions and power and privileges, to be thrown to the very end, to be given the worst housing, to have to be the last in line for basic necessities like milk and bread, to undergo constant and daily persecution for upholding the name of Jesus Christ. When people convert to Christianity from being a Muslim or a Buddhist or a Hindu or even a Jew, such people find themselves separated from their families, cast out from their families, cast out from society, considered wicked and abominable. When I was serving a first parish in Evansville, Indiana, one day I received a phone call in the office, and it was the National Organization of Jews for Jesus. And the person on the other end of the line was asking me, or telling me, that 2 young girls were going to be coming to Evansville on their way to California. And they wondered if my wife and I would be willing to put them up in the parsonage. And they said, you know, they couldn't vouch for them, that we didn't have to worry when we went to sleep that they were going to slit our throats or steal us blind or whatever. And so I talked it over with Gina, and we said yes. And at that time, Aaron and Joel were 4 and 3, or 3 and 2. I don't think Matthew was born. And so these 2 young ladies came the next day, at summertime, and we And Gina and I sat there in amazement as she told the story of how when she informed her family that she had become a Christian, that they went to the synagogue and had a funeral service for her. And in their eyes, in the eyes of all her aunts and uncles, her brothers and sisters, her cousins, they all considered her dead, as if she had been struck down by a car crossing the highway, or been in a wreck, or struck by lightning, or eaten by a shark in the ocean, or whatever. No matter how much she tried to reestablish contact with them, they absolutely would refuse to have any relationship with her. And that happened all over the world. That happened to all over the world with people from other religions convert to the Christian faith. They are excluded, separated, cast out from society as being considered wicked or abominable. Then, Jesus says, we can expect from the world that they will revile. The word revile means to heap insults on someone. It means to denounce them, to find fault with them, to rebuke them. What is interesting is when you examine the history of the church, the early Christians were peaceable and they were obedient. St. Peter and St. Paul, the other writers of the epistles in our New Testament, tell us to honor those in authority. We have to remember these were written when Rome was persecuting the church. Yet their commands to their followers at that time were to honor the emperor, the kings, the magistrates, whoever they were being ruled by. The only exception was if they asked you to do something contrary to the will of God. And so you had certain provinces where the demand was that once a year you would throw a pinch of incense into at a temple in the name of some god in order to show your allegiance to Caesar. Of course, Christians would not do that because they did not recognize any other god. And so they'd be persecuted and even executed. And so we would be accused of all kinds of horrible actions. They would hear this about Christians gathering together and eating the body and blood of somebody. And so the rumors would be that Christians were cannibals, and that when they gathered together, they would sacrifice somebody and then eat them as part of their worship, because they did not understand the theology of the sacrament of the altar, the Lord's Supper, Holy Communion, the Eucharist. And so that is how they would be treated. And then, he says, they will defame you. The word defame means to reject, to take out, to remove, to drive out, to expel. Even today, there are countries where Christians are rejected for being Christian. They're driven out of a village or out of a territory. They're removed. Or they're expelled. And all types of violence is shown against them. Some of the countries today that we see Christians going through such suffering, and yet they are blessed. Myanmar. When I was growing up, we knew this as Burma. A couple of years ago, some militant Buddhists beat and killed the Christians trying to go to worship on a Sunday morning. Timor, the Philippines. And when we hear the Philippines, we think of the Philippines as being a Christian nation, but there's one little section that is controlled by some Muslim radicals who want to overthrow the rightful government of the Philippines and establish Sharia law and so forth. And in that area, the Philippines Christians are persecuted and killed. India, one of our allies, just a year or so ago, A young missionary couple pulled off the side of the road to sleep for the night because they were in between villages. As they were sleeping, and this was a young husband and wife, only in their 20s. During the night, militant Hindus snuck up on them, poured flammable liquid all over their Jeep, lit it on fire, and burned the couple to death within their Jeep. The sedan, we've seen for years, the attempts of Northern Sudan, which is predominantly Muslim, to crush Southern Sudan, which is predominantly Christian. So the UN has had to step in and try to separate and bring it into the fire. China. You can be a Christian in China as long as you belong to one of the state-sanctioned churches. But of course, if you belong to one of those, then the state dictates what the priest or the pastor, the minister may say and not say. Another one of our allies, Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia, it's against the law to build a church. In Saudi Arabia, it's against the law to convert someone to the Christian faith. Yet they are blessed and they're suffering. North Korea, really don't need to say much about North Korea, you just look at the leader. If you've paid attention to the news lately, they say his wife's missing. And they think what has happened is he's done away with his wife because she displeased him in some way. He had an uncle killed not too long ago who was one of his defense ministers because he didn't like something he had said. He's probably the closest thing to a modern day Herod that we've seen. He's so paranoid. Christianity is persecuted and executed in North Korea. Iran is against the law to convert people to Christianity. The church is constantly harassed. And wherever ISIS or Boko Haram control the territory, Christians are immediately sought out to be slaughtered, to be tortured, to be made an example of. And yet, all these brothers and sisters in Christ are blessed. So the first lesson that we learn is what to expect from the world. The second lesson is, how do we respond? Do we respond with vengeance? Does our Lord Jesus Christ tell us to raise up an army and attack an area with the slogan, convert or die? No. The Lord Jesus Christ says, instead, love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who abuse you. If anyone strikes you on the cheek, offer the other also. From anyone who takes away your coat, you're not withholding in your shirt. We are called to respond to him. And he tells us in verse 23, rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for surely your reward is great in heaven. For that is what their ancestors did to the prophets, to rejoice. The meaning of that word is to be glad, to be delighted, be in a state of delight, to be in a state of happiness. And it's an imagery of a young calf or a colt or a young lamb or a goat leaping in a pasture in the warmth of the spring sun. So as Christians, Jesus is telling us that we are blessed because there's something greater than the things in the world. Dr. William Hart, a theologian and professor at Concordia Seminary, says, speaking of Christians, quote, the world may despise them, but what of it? What counts is God's verdict. End quote. That is why Jesus tells us to be blessed even in suffering, because it's God's verdict that counts. As we sang last week, in the hymn, A Mighty Fortress. They may take our life. They may take our house and spouse. They may take our children. They may take all that we have. But they can still not triumph over our Lord Jesus Christ. This is why Paul could write so convincingly
that nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord, because it's God's verdict that is important. And on that great getting up morning, on that day when we cross to that far side back of Jordan, when we go to that land that is fair than day, which by faith we see from afar, we will hear our Heavenly Father say to us, not guilty, not even not guilty, but we'll hear him say, come into the place prepared for you. Well done, good and faithful servant. Come to that mansion that my Son has prepared for you since that day you entered into the community of faith through that sacrament of baptism. And so what matters is God's verdict. So this is how we can be blessed in suffering. No matter what the world does, it cannot take away that eternal promise. Won for us by Jesus suffering and death upon that Roman cross outside the walls of Jerusalem that first Good Friday. That death upon the cross paying the debt of sin that we washing us clean with his blood so that God does not see a sinner, but sees a child of the Heavenly Father, an heir to the kingdom, a brother or sister of Jesus Christ. So on all this All Saints Day, we remember the most despised, the most hated, the most persecuted of people in all of history. Remembering those martyrs and those brothers and sisters in Christ who've gone before us peacefully. And rejoicing in the fact that we are numbered among those saints. And that one day we'll join them in that eternal kingdom of heaven. Therefore, as we live and continue our pilgrimage on earth, we truly are blessed, even in suffering. Amen. Peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen.
As you can to his eyes. To the words of the Nicene Creed, we believe in one Lord,
the Father the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally God of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
You may be seated. Let us pray. Blessing, glory, wisdom, thanksgiving, honor, power, and might be to you, our God, now and forever. Hear us, we pray, in peace, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Our response today is, Lord, have mercy. For the church and for all her members, who belong to you by baptism and faith, for our gathering this day at the bidding of the Lamb, our Shepherd, for ears to hear his word, and for faith to receive him, who becomes comes to us in holy body and blood. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the ministers of the church who bring the good news of Christ's death and resurrection, and for the Spirit to the work through the preaching of this gospel to gather the lost, kindle faith in those who do not yet believe, and sustain us all the day of Christ's coming. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the world and those who lead us in the nations and every place, for the reign of peace among the nations, for the good laws and the respect of those laws, and for the thankful hearts to receive God's grace and to give us grace responsibly, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the many who suffer in body or spirit, for their healing and comfort, for grace to sustain them in their trials, and for patience to endure the day of trouble, and for those who whom the name in our hearts, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the blessedness of the Spirit to lead us to conform our daily lives in Christ and His work. For each of us as Christians, that the Lord may raise us among us peacemakers, those who love righteousness, those who teach us steadfastness of heart, and will in service to Christ, our neighbor. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For glad hearts created clean and new, for the joy of salvation, for desire of love, the Lord above all things, and serve Him with the worship of our lips and our lives. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For thankful hearts, for the grace of all of us, who God hath given us the glory of His, and according to His gracious will, and for the sacrifices of thanksgiving, we bring in praise the goodness of the Lord. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the cause of the poor and the poor in spirit, for those who are persecuted for the sake of faith, for the martyrs who give all who remain faithful, and for the remembrances of the blessed, dead, and who die in the Lord, and rest in their labors, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Standing with those on every tribe and nation before the Lamb of God, we rejoice and cry out, salvation belongs to our God, who sits on the throne, and to the Lamb of God, to whom the glory with the Father and all His Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Maybe take the towel over.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
that we may delight in your mercy and rejoice with them in glory. And so with all the saints, with the choir of angels and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join them in any hymn.
We thank Jesus Christ for dying for us, for leaving us not orphans, but to be with him forever as he is here with us in his body and his blood. And we receive this every Sunday and high holy days, every Wednesday night. Christ is with us. He has done this wonderful thing, died for us, and left this gift of himself, the Holy Spirit, with us. We'll never be alone. We never have to be by ourselves. We always have the Holy Spirit. We have the gift of the body and blood of Jesus Christ, which we're receiving right now. The mystical body and blood. We're all one. It's All Saints Day. All those who have died and gone before us are here with us, taking communion with us today, All Saints Day.
Body of the Lord Jesus Christ, with his precious blood, strengthen and preserve your true faith unto life eternal.
Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you provide the true bread from heaven, your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Grant that we who have received the sacrament of his body and blood may abide in him and he in us, that we may be filled with the power of his endless life, now and forever.
Dorothy Morgan, G. Chandler Beard, Russell A. Nittman, Robert R. Wagner, Dolores J. Nittman, Mariana M. Mills, Harry T. Weagle, Charles J. Berger, Patty Leninger, Mary E. Caldwell, Eloise M. Miller, Keith A. Dunn. As we remember these people, strengthen us to follow Christ through this world until we are carried into the harvest of eternal life, where suffering and death will be no more. Hear our prayers in the name of the good and gracious Shepherd, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Lord Jesus, by your death you took away the sting of death. Strengthen us to follow in faith where you have led the way, that we may at length fall asleep in you and awake in your likeness. To you, the author and giver of life, be all honor and glory now and forever. Amen. O Lord, support us all the day long of this troubled life, until the shadows lengthen and the evening comes, the busy world is hushed, the fever of life is over, and our work is done. Then in your mercy, grant us a safe lodging and a holy rest and peace at the last, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Almighty and merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless, comfort, strengthen, and keep us, now and forever. Amen. We conclude our celebration with Rock of Ages, hymn number 623, in the back of your worship book. Hymn number 623.
Our final hymn was written by an Episcopal priest in 1776. It's Rock of Ages. And the author is Augustus M. Toplady. A very prestigious name, Augustus M. Toplady. The Episcopal priest, he started writing these hymns when he was 14. Very precocious, Rock of Ages, in memory of those who have gone and died before us, All Saints Day.
God and peace, serve the Lord.
happy to have you worship with us this All Saints Day as we honored those 13 people in our church who have died in the past year. We've read their names, we've prayed for them, we had communion for them, and they are here with us. Jesus is with us, and he promises us that we are all one body. Thank you for watching St. John's. Tune in any time on YouTube. We offer a Christian school program. We're hoping to get it started again in January. It's we're not able to get it going right now because we don't have an administrator. For more information, call the church office, 325-4311. Tune in any time. We thank you for joining us in our worship this morning today. St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Our pastor, Pastor John Pollock. We provide food for the hungry. We provide about 8,000 meals a month for those who are in need or homeless, who are unable to have food here in our community. We hope and we pray that God will continue to bless you and keep you this day. We'll pray for you and continue to pray for us and our YouTube ministry. We'd love to have you join us. 8 o'clock church service, 10:30 church service every Sunday, 9:15 will be the Sunday school, and 6:30 every Wednesday is Holy Communion. Receive communion at least once a week here. Body and blood of Jesus Christ. He died. He's not left us alone. He is here with us with the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Jesus was here on earth for his ministry. And after he died, he established Holy Communion so that he could be with us forever.